Good morning, everyone. My name is Grit McCreath, and I am a proud alumna and the honorary ambassador for the University of Saskatchewan. It is an incredible pleasure to be here today and to present Peter Stoychef as the 11th President and Vice Chancellor of the University of Saskatchewan. We have so much to celebrate. The university searched the entire globe for our new president, and we found him right here at home on our campus, immersed in our culture. We are people of the prairies, strong roots, outward looking, sense of community, helping the world. This university is profoundly important to this province, and in many scholarly disciplines, we make a difference to Canada and beyond. As a former member of the Board of Governors, I have had many opportunities to interact with Peter in his role as Dean of the College of Arts and Science. In my heart, I could not be more thrilled that Peter has been chosen to lead the university as we start a new chapter. This is our time, and this is the right person. I am confident many of you feel the same based on the energy and enthusiasm and sheer joy expressed in Convocation Hall in July when Greg Smith, Chairman of the Board, announced Peter's upcoming presidency. The hall erupted in cheers with the announcement. It left me with goosebumps, and it's a moment I will never forget. Peter grew up in a family that connected the sciences with the arts. His father, a physicist, and his mother, a musician and lover of literature. Their early influence shaped Peter in ways that are still apparent today, especially his time in arts and science, where he continually worked to connect science, social science, humanities, and fine arts. With a PhD in literature from the University of Toronto, Peter joined the University of Saskatchewan in 1986, 29 years ago, as a faculty member in the Department of English. Peter held the position of Vice Dean of Humanities and Fine Arts in the College of Arts and Science from 2005 to 2010, and stepped into the role of Dean in 2011. Peter has a passion for teaching and for his students. It only takes a few minutes walking across the bowl with him to realize the connections he has made with students, both at the undergraduate and graduate levels. Peter was recognized for this passion in 2002 with the Distinguished Graduate Supervisor Award. He is highly regarded internationally for his work in modern literature and his exploration of the history of books and their future in our digital age. He has also served in national and provincial leadership roles in research and scholarly and artistic work, including membership on the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council, National Committee, and Doctoral Committee. Those who know Peter would say he truly captures the essence of what our university and our province stand for. He is hardworking, humble, and down to earth. And he has so much heart. He knows every corner of the university and is well respected by faculty, staff, students, and alumni alike. On top of this, he is an incredibly gifted classical guitarist and composer, a gift he has shared with the campus community in the past, and I'm hopeful he will continue to do. To his family and friends joining us today to celebrate, I know your support has and will continue to mean the world to Peter as you start this new adventure together. I would be remiss if I did not mention his wonderful family. Peter's wife, Catherine, his daughter, Alexandra, and son, Christopher. He will not be making this journey alone. He has a strong team to support him and to cheer him on. This is an unbelievable institution, an emerging scholarly artistic research university, a member of the U15, steeped in the tradition of distinguishing itself by graduating students who have become leaders. Under your guidance, this will continue and grow. Congratulations, Peter. I wish you all the best as you officially take on the role of our president. Eminent Chancellor, on behalf of the Board of Governors of the University of Saskatchewan, I present Peter Stoychev and ask that he be installed as the 11th President and Vice Chancellor of the University of Saskatchewan.
Do you, Peter Stoychev, pledge yourself to perform the duties of President and Vice Chancellor of the University of Saskatchewan as prescribed by law and by the statutes of the university? And do you promise to defend the rights and promote the welfare of the university and the members thereof?
I do so promise.
In the name of the University of Saskatchewan, I now install you, Peter Stoychev, in the office of President and Vice Chancellor of the university, and I invest you with the authority and charge you with the responsibility pertaining to that office. Congratulations.
Well, good morning, everyone. President Stoychev. Good morning. Chancellor Blaine Fable, our board chair, Greg Smith, Premiers Romano and Calvert, President Timmins, welcome to all of those from other institutions for both inside the province of Saskatchewan and across our nation to celebrate this morning. His Worship Don Acheson, Chief Thomas, honorable recipients of awards this morning, and all honored guests, and in particular, good morning and welcome to the graduate, the convocates, and their families here this morning. It brings me great pleasure to be here on behalf of our Premier, the Honorable Brad Wall, and the Government of Saskatchewan. This is an exciting day for the University of Saskatchewan. It's an exciting day for the province of Saskatchewan as we install our 11th President and Vice Chancellor at this university. And I want to congratulate and welcome Dr. Peter Stoychev, or now President Stoychev. I was so very fortunate, as many others, to attend the event on campus here back in July when this selection was announced. And I couldn't help but be struck by the enthusiasm of the crowd when the choice was made. There's a room full of faculty, full of students, alumni, community members, and they absolutely erupted when Dr. Stoychev emerged from behind the curtain on the stage that day. It's a moment that I will not soon forget, and I'm sure it's a moment that our president will not soon forget. I knew right then and there that this was the right choice for our university, and I was clearly not alone in my confidence of this institution and my confidence in the president-elect. Dr. Stoychev has a number of strengths that will prove to be extremely valuable as we move into the future. His past experience as professor, vice dean, and most recently as a dean of the College of Arts and Science show a deep commitment to post-secondary education and this institution in particular. The University of Saskatchewan is an important part of the province socially. It's an important part of the province economically and culturally. Leading this great institution is no small task, and I am confident that the University of Saskatchewan is on a positive path. I know the University of Saskatchewan will continue to make significant and tangible contributions under President Stoychev's leadership. To the students here today, I'd like to extend to you my congratulations to the many of you that are convocating. Today is a moment to reflect on the hard work and to celebrate just how far you've came. You, along with your family, can be so very proud of your accomplishments. But this is also a time to look forward to the opportunities that lie ahead for you. I wish you every success wherever your path may lead you, whether it be further education or as you begin a new career. And I can tell you from my personal experience that your University of Saskatchewan education will serve you well in whatever you choose to pursue and wherever your life will lead you. And it's now up to you to make those choices about the path that you wish to walk on. So congratulations in closing again to our President Stoychev, to those honorary recipients here today. Congratulations again to all of those that are convocating here today, and congratulations to your families on your achievements. Thank you again for having me here today.
Eminent Chancellor, eminent President and Vice Chancellor, distinguished platform guests, colleagues, graduates, ladies and gentlemen. It is a pleasure and a privilege to offer a few words of welcome from the faculty at the University of Saskatchewan to our 11th president, whose installation in that office is occurring here today in Saskatoon at fall convocation in Treaty 6 territory. Mine is a voice coming from the faculty, but not claiming to speak for all the faculty. We are a university, after all, where debate and dissent are arguably as valuable as agreement and belief. Unanimity on campus is as elusive as the Higgs boson or the Maple Leafs' next Stanley Cup. And that's exactly how it should be. That said, I have taught here for 40 years and recently served as an elected faculty representative on the search committee for our new president. Believe me, colleagues are not shy about telling you what they think about the outcome of a process that accessed and evaluated a deep and diverse pool of remarkably talented candidates from across Canada and across the world. The rigor and reach of the search process offered reassurance about the successful candidate, as did the tone he himself set when the announcement of his selection was made. In the case of Dr. Stoychev, the feedback I've received from colleagues has been overwhelmingly positive. There is a strong desire among faculty for this new presidency to be a resounding success. Equally importantly, there is a collective faculty resolve to assist whenever and wherever possible in achieving such a result, because that will benefit not only the university community, but the whole province, all of Canada, and our many international partners and supporters. And it will do so in multiple ways: economic, social, cultural, environmental, reputational. President Stoychev may not have as much on his plate as Justin Trudeau currently does, but he faces a similar challenge, namely to bring people together in order that they bring out the best in themselves and in others, both neighbors and strangers, and to collaborate in shaping and realizing a common vision, both welcoming and challenging. Unshrinking the U of S is as imperative as unshrinking Canada. For those of you here who may think my analogy between prime ministers and university presidents far-fetched or inappropriate for other reasons, it is worth remembering that as democracy goes, so go universities. And as universities go, so goes democracy. Institutions like ours need to function as deliberative communities, modeling the values of collegial governance, free inquiry, and unfettered exchange, so as to continuously reveal the essential but insufficiently understood connections between academic freedom and academic excellence. That is why in the policy statement on academic freedom produced by the Canadian Association of University Teachers, after restating that fundamental freedom as also an equally fundamental responsibility, we find the following sentence, quote, "Robust democracies require no less." So the stakes are high and the public interest most emphatically in play for all academic staff as well as academic leaders as we support, supplement, contest, and hence enrich and enliven what our new president means when he calls the university a cultural institution, and when he organizes our key activities under four headings: to inquire, to inform, to innovate, and to indigenize. This latter commitment to indigenize is especially important at this stage in the history of our province and of Canada, and will require a serious heeding and creative response to the TRC's recent call to action. But we can do it, in part because our new president has identified this priority with courage and clarity, and a willingness to enlist our help in making the commonalities we celebrate and the differences we value interact productively, while we insist on understanding the University of Saskatchewan as both particle and wave, edifice and energy, repaying in traditional but also in unexpected ways public investment and the public trust. And so, Peter, I conclude by wishing you, from within the regularly fractious but immensely talented faculty complement, good health, good luck, good judgment, and of course, good funding.
Good morning. My name is Jack Salabak. I'm the current president of the University of Saskatchewan Students' Union, and I'm here to give some amazing words in regards to a congratulatory message to our new president here, Peter Stoychev. I'd also like to acknowledge that we are on Treaty 6 lands, and as a Treaty 6 member, I'm glad to be here. But before I move into the congratulatory message, I'd like to acknowledge all the students who are sitting here today and the amazing work that you've done to come so far. I see a lot of familiar faces here, and someday I'll be where you're sitting, hopefully. But Peter, you are coming into a very interesting Saskatchewan community, a very interesting University of Saskatchewan community. We have a diverse set of students from various races, from various nationalities, from... Your cell phone's going. sorry. From various backgrounds, sexual orientations, gender identities, and you yourself are a very diverse individual, and we acknowledge that you come from a large college. The Arts and Science College was a huge success because of your leadership. The selection process was one of anticipation. As a student, I looked forward to finding out who would be coming in. And when the announcement was made, there was a very robust applause that came out. Because you brought forward a unified leadership, the unified vision, and a very actionable future for us here at the university. So all in all, it was a very welcomed position that came forward. I say these last words with conviction, because in certain speeches, being able to talk about what I envision for the university is very important. And I say these two quotes here, that Peter, we welcome you. We welcome all of that you have coming forward. Your love for the university, for the city, the province, and this country shine through. And we look forward to your kind leadership and strong vision for the whole university. So on behalf of the students, the undergraduate students and the graduate students, we welcome you and thank you very much for taking on this very large role. Thank you very much, Peter.
Haneen. Good morning to all that are present here. I want to thank Joel for the prayer, as well as Wild Horse for the drum group, to Chancellor Favel, President Stoichev, President Saddleback, as well as Minister Moe, MLAs Rob Norris and Cam Broughton, and to all of you. We wouldn't be able to have this ceremony, no matter how important we think we may be out here, we wouldn't have it without the graduates, so congratulations. As a proud alumni of the University of Saskatchewan, my wife and I are both alumni. We have four children, two that have gone through the university and two that are presently in university. It's great to see some of the comments that have been made about working together. When we see the demographics and we look at the numbers that were released this past week, when I was going to school there, it was very little. And some of the graduates that are here now, you'll know that you're part of history. For some of those Aboriginal graduates and some of the new Canadians and some of the older Canadians, you're the first one in your generation to graduate from the University of Saskatchewan. You're the first one to graduate from any university. If you think about that, you're trailblazers, and you can do your part. When we talk about treaties were meant to be inclusive. They're to provide an inclusive opportunity for the settlers. And more than that, they're also to provide opportunity for First Nations and Aboriginal people to be a part of society, be a part of the economy, be a part of education. And education at that time was seen, that'll be our new buffalo. That'll gain us a place in society. Unfortunately, didn't happen that way, but it doesn't have to happen that way. As we move forward under the leadership of President Stoichev, Chancellor Favel, and all the people of Saskatchewan, we can implement parts of treaties. Actually, we can implement all of treaties. If we had treaties implementation, we wouldn't need studies. We wouldn't need inquiries. We wouldn't need commissions. We would have a just society where First Nations, Aboriginal people, Métis and Inuit and non-First Nations can live in prosperity and can live in inclusiveness. And it's important in Saskatchewan that we do that. As I said, not only the demographics of the university, but the demographics of Saskatchewan and Saskatoon. President Stoichev, you're the right person, at the right place, at the right time, and as part of the Saskatoon Tribal Council leadership, this is the right thing to do, and we're here to help whatever way we can. So with that, congratulations. Congratulations to the graduates. And we could all live in a society that's not only inclusive, but blind in terms of race, gender, and so that we can all live in a society that we can be a part of history. And I think we all want to do that. So with that, thank you very much.
Well, good morning, everyone. I really appreciate the words that have been said so far. I fear that many of you thought you were coming here to watch your family members, loved ones, friends cross the stage and get a degree, and suddenly a presidential installation broke out. But I feel that in response to the things that have been said, because you're here and because we are on the stage lucky enough to have all of you here to share in this moment, I do feel that I have a responsibility to say something about what I feel about the past of this university, the present of this university, and more particularly the future of this university. And in so doing, actually, to implicitly send a message to the graduates here today. Congratulations to all of you. that the university that you are getting a degree from is an institution of excellence, and your degree that you have worked so hard to get and so many people have supported you in getting is a degree that has tremendous value. Eminent Chancellor, students and families, honored guests, I thank the many people who are here today to be part of this moment in the history of the University of Saskatchewan. In particular, I do want to acknowledge the presidents of the Minister of Advanced Education, the Honourable Scott Moe. Thank you for your words, sir. His Worship, the Mayor of Saskatoon, Don Acheson, I know is here. Chief Wappas was here, a member of the drum group. Thank you very much. Former Chancellors Ted Turner, Peggy McKercher, Tom Malloy, and Vera Pezer, as introduced to you, thank you very much for coming here for this special occasion. Elder Maurice, thank you very much, sir. Former Premiers Roy Romano and Lauren Calvert, University of Regina President Vianne Timmins, St. Thomas More President Terence Downey, thank you very much for being here. Saskatchewan Polytechnic President Larry Rosie, I know, is here today. Executive Director of the U15 Group of Canadian Research Universities, Suzanne Corbet, thank you very much for being here today. President of Universities Canada, Paul Davidson. My wife, Catherine, and our children, Alexander and Christopher, and my dear friends who are here from New York, Boston, and Toronto, and family members from Montana and Calgary and Regina. I would like to thank the many faculty who are here as well today. The presence of everyone, and this is the point, demonstrates the significant place the University of Saskatchewan holds in the hearts and the minds, in the souls of the people of this province, this city, Canada, and beyond. And I'm proud to say that as we gather here today, we acknowledge we are in Treaty 6 territory in the homeland of the Métis. We pay our respects to the First Nations and Métis ancestors of this place and reaffirm our relationship with each other. This university has been in my imagination for many years, long before I moved here with my wife almost 30 years ago to become a new faculty member in the English department. The name of the university would wind its way through conversations during my childhood in Ottawa, where my father, a physicist, worked at the National Research Council. The president of the National Research Council was from this university. There was talk about him. And my father worked with the Nobel laureate Gerhard Hertzberg, who had been a faculty member here for 13 years, many years before that. And Dr. Hertzberg's daughter, Agnes, is on the stage this morning. Thank you very much, Agnes, for being here as well. As I went to school and later to university, I learned the history of things such as the Cobalt 60, built and used here by researchers like Harold Johns and graduate student Sylvia Fedoric at the time. It was the first in the world to successfully treat a cancer patient using Cobalt 60 radiation therapy. It revolutionized cancer treatment and saved the lives of millions of cancer patients around the world. I knew about some of the country's most formative political leaders associated with the university, such as John Diefenbaker, Raymond Natician, then afterwards of Premiers Grant Devine and Roy Romano and Lauren Calvert, and later, of course, Premier Wall. I knew about graduate students such as Henry Tobey, who, like Dr. Hertzberg, went on to win the Nobel Prize in Chemistry. I knew about writers Sharon Butala, Guy Vanderhaeghe, social scientists like Hilda Neepy and Mabel Timlin and Norman Ward, about music composers like David Kaplan and artists like Eli Bornstein. I had heard about actors like Henry Wolfe and Kim Coates and Carol Greyeyes and Aboriginal leaders like Frida Henicu and more recently our Chancellor Blaine Fable, former chief of the FSIN. Those people, the positive impact they had and continue to have on the lives of others were in my imagination long before I came here. The books they wrote, the art they created, the political parties they led, the scientific innovation they drove, the public policy they changed, the leadership that they provided. And because of these people, I knew I wanted to be part of that university. When I arrived here, I learned more. The role of the medical college in leading healthcare innovation in the province and the world. About the College of Agriculture and leading farming innovation and research with a huge return on investment and improvement in the lives of people of this province and throughout the world. Of the Western College of Veterinary Medicine and its prominent role in animal care and research nationally and internationally. The great athletes and coaches who were here and who were trained here. The fact that this is the only College of Arts and Science at a major university in this country that houses everything from the fine arts through the humanities, the social sciences, and the sciences. There isn't a music teacher in this province who has not benefited in some way from our music department and our music education program. There isn't a visual artist who has not been associated in some way with our studio art program. There isn't a theater director or actor or playwright who has not in some way been influenced by our drama department, the first in the Commonwealth. I learned that we are seen as a research leader in this country with Canada's only synchrotron, one of the world's most advanced vaccine research facilities at Vito Intervac, a cyclotron, excellent nursing programs and research, colleges and graduate schools of dentistry, pharmacy and nutrition, kinesiology, education, engineering, business, law, environment and sustainability, public health and public policy, as well as an excellent library system to support their work and groundbreaking accomplishments and alumni of which they can all be proud. I learned we have one of the greatest arrays of colleges and disciplines of any university in this country. This to me is a crucial feature of who we are, because although we do not know what the solutions are to the major challenges facing us today, we do know this, that none of them will be solved by a single discipline or a single person, but by many people from many disciplines working together. We are poised to help do that. To the graduates here this morning, reflect on these people and colleges and graduate schools and what they've contributed, and know that you have earned a degree from an institution with a history of excellence. And by virtue of this, your degree has tremendous value as you move out into the world and make a difference yourselves. For my part, I'm humbled by these people who have gone before us, as we all will be by you. And I see my role to be creating always the conditions for that excellence to grow, to be valued, and to be supported. So this university has a history of excellence and a future of tremendous potential. And that is because it has had students like you who followed a passion during the time they were here and then converted that passion into contribution, into a positive impact on others. They were compelled to do what they've done. They were drawn to it. They loved doing it. They saw the significance in what they were doing and how it contributed to their communities and beyond. They learned from faculty who were doing research, scholarly, and artistic work at a high level, as do the faculty on the stage with us here this morning. Don't let anyone tell you to drop your dreams of a life of contribution and impact because they seem too big or unrealistic. Seek opportunities to lead change, remembering that you are here to understand how people have thought beyond what they were told was true. You are not here just to accept received wisdom. You stand at a threshold like I do this morning, ready to take a step into a future that each of us can only partially discern. With trepidation, I can tell you, and excitement. But we will do it with passion, and we will do it with compassion, the greater measure of us than how much we acquire and consume. Given that the U of S has a past and present of excellence, what is its future? That's the question we need collectively to answer and to act upon. What is its future? When the university's first president, President Murray, was traveling to Saskatoon to begin his work here in August of 1908, he wrote to a friend that we must remember that we are building for centuries. What is the role of the modern university in a time of change? Maybe a time of the greatest change humankind has seen. And what is the responsibility that you and I and all of us here carry with us through the great privilege of being part of this university, of having the kind of educational opportunity the vast majority of, of people in this world can only dream of? One thing I know from our history is that it's a university where problems can be solved, challenges can be met, where we see the beauty in truth and truth in beauty, where the arts and sciences at their highest levels aspire to the same end, that creativity and innovation in a university are the fires that stoke the engines of change, and that the world needs that creativity and innovation desperately today. And if the world is changing faster than it ever has, and the challenges it faces are arguably the most urgent it has ever faced, I would say universities are needed now more than they have ever been, and the University of Saskatchewan is needed now more than it has ever been. We are needed globally. We know at the U of S that our reach is global in selected areas, that we have the expertise to help solve global challenges, particularly around food and water security, infectious disease, and environment, and I have no doubt that that list of areas will grow as time goes on. We were this summer one of only 5 universities in Canada to succeed in the largest federal research funding program this country has ever created, the Canada First Research Excellence Fund. Not everybody thought we could do it, but we did it because we have the talent, the perseverance, and the creativity. And through this research program led by our Global Institute for Food Security, we will help many, many people worldwide to have far greater access to food. Our global reach means international partnerships in research, scholarly, and artistic work, attracting students and faculty here from other countries, and all of us benefiting from the intellectual and cultural richness that such diversity brings. We're needed by this country. Universities like ours, members of the U15, the most research-intensive medical doctoral universities in Canada, contribute $8.5 billion in research and educate over 500,000 students annually, stimulating innovation and the economy. Collectively, all 100 or so universities in this country contribute $35 billion and are drivers of economic prosperity. Canada ranks only in the middle of countries worldwide in terms of innovation, which is a key to all of our futures, and is at risk of being left behind by other surging global economies. Research partnerships with communities, governments, and companies are critical to ensuring that discoveries and insights advance our ability to meet social, health, and economic needs. Universities like ours hold the expertise to make Canada a leader, not a follower in this respect. We are needed by the province whose name we bear, whose current government is planning for growth, whose population is increasing and deserves access to training, talent, and creativity along with careers. The U of S contributes over $1 billion annually to the Saskatchewan economy. We must ensure we fulfill these roles of access and internationalization and work with all of our post-secondary partners in the province, many of them represented here today, to collectively offer the best education we possibly can to the people of Saskatchewan. And we know that we occupy a special place in the imagination of this city, that all great cities need a great university to forge and attract talent. As the world's population shifts from rural to urban, as it has in Canada recently, our role in the city of Saskatoon, federally designated a cultural capital of Canada and locally dubbing itself Science City, grows ever larger. All this tells me that we are regarded as and need to see ourselves confidently as an agent of cultural change, building on our community of almost 150,000 alumni, countless supporters and stakeholders worldwide like all of you here who expect nothing less than that we continue to take our well-earned place among the best. Leading the intellectual, scientific, professional, artistic, medical, and environmental enrichment of the people, in short, a cultural institution. That's our purpose. That's the place we occupy as a cultural institution leading transformative change. It's an implicit social contract we have with the public to provide an environment for students and faculty to inquire, for them to advance knowledge by informing, for administrators to sustain the conditions for that to occur, for all of us together emboldened by that knowledge to create significant positive change by innovating, and also to inquire, inform, and innovate, because knowledge is something to acquire for its own sake. There's precious little of it around during times of spiritual need. The deep things are not found just because they're useful, but because it was possible to find them, because they led us somewhere we couldn't envision. Literature and history and philosophy, all the humanities, speak to us and must be cherished and studied and taught. And the laser was not invented so that the world could play Blu-ray, DVDs, or scan barcodes, or even do new surgical procedures, wonderful as all those things are, but because someone wanted to see if the naturally scattered state of light waves could be made coherent and parallel. The laser was a solution waiting for a problem, not the other way around. So our contract is to inquire, to inform, and to innovate. and in doing those things, to be a dedicated servant to a democratic society and a responsible critic of it. A dedicated servant to a democratic society and a responsible critic of it. That's why academic freedom is so important to us, to who we are, and to what we do. It's our fundamental legitimizing concept. But there is a challenge we face in this country that will define whether or not we can say we have fulfilled the mission of the modern university. And it takes the form of the calls to action of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. We must become the best place we possibly can be for Aboriginal students and their communities in this province and beyond it. That is a crucial role for the modern university in this country, to respond to the most urgent issue of our time, and in so doing to play a role in reimagining Canada. How can Canada do this if its universities cannot? I ask myself that question. How can Canada do this if its universities cannot? The University of Saskatchewan has been working to achieve that, but it's not yet enough. And the TRC's calls to action make that crystal clear. I can tell you that other universities in this country look to us to make a difference in their regard. They're trying a lot as well, but they're also looking to us. And so I ask myself and I ask you, if not us, who? And in the wake of the TRC's calls to action, and with the country's 150th anniversary approaching, if not now, when? If not us, who? And if not now, when? And that is why I say that this is a university whose future rests on its great potential to inquire, to inform, to innovate, and to indigenize. We will learn more when Chancellor Favel and I, in partnership with the Assembly of First Nations National Chief Perry Bellegarde, co-host a national forum with Aboriginal university and student leaders here November 18th and 19th that focuses on how to implement the TRC's calls to action specific to the post-secondary education sector. But now, what indigenize means to me is that we rethink and we be open to rethinking what we mean by inquiring and forming and innovating to become a more welcoming place for Aboriginal students. It is bringing together Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal traditions of inquiring and informing and innovating for everyone's benefit in a spirit of tolerance and respect. It means a concerted and cooperative effort to respect, expand, and enrich the knowledge systems, the ways of knowing, languages, traditions, heritages, and experience of Aboriginal peoples of Canada with the other knowledge systems of the great minds at this university. In a moment, you will hear a piece performed by the University of Saskatchewan Wind Orchestra, written by the late composer David Kaplan, who led the music department here for many years. Its title is Miu Chetawin, and it means good relations. It brings together many traditions, Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal, into a musical vision of a way forward for us all. In this space together this morning, we are part of the exponential power of this cultural institution, this university's community. I am honored to be assuming the role as its president and vice chancellor, privileged that our graduates and their families and all of you are here this morning to share with me in this ceremony. And I am with all of you united in a desire to do what's right, to make a difference, to take our honored place among the best, and to use that place of privilege for the benefit of all. Together, we are building for centuries. Eminent Chancellor, thank you very much. Thanks, everybody, today.
The live music presented to you this morning has been provided by Wild Horse Drum Group singing the University of Saskatchewan's own honor song composed by Tyrone Tatusis. Henry Gardeby Sr. on fiddle, accompanied by Donnie Anaquad. The song performed was entitled Whiskey Before Breakfast. The treaty song has been performed on stage by singers and hand drummers Robert Badger, Donald Speedall, Henry Gardeby Jr., his son Colby Gardeby, John Noon, and Mark Longjohn. The university wishes to thank all of the First Nations special guest performers from Treaty 4 and Treaty 6 for making this event so unique and memorable. Thank you, one and all. A bit about the song itself. Miwacha Duwen was composed by the late Professor Emeritus David Kaplan. It's been performed by the University of Saskatchewan Wind Orchestra, conducted by Darren Olerking. The composition is based on the Cree word Miwesadowen, which means good relationship. Dr. David Kaplan spent nearly 40 years teaching in the University of Saskatchewan Department of Music. He was the founding conductor of the University Concert Band, which later became today's Wind Orchestra, and also served as conductor for the Saskatoon Symphony Orchestra. Dr. Kaplan believed in forging meaningful relationships through music, whether it was through his original compositions or through his extensive research and collection of musical instruments from around the world. Today's composition was originally composed in 2012 for the Saskatoon Public Schools as part of a music education advocacy event. Dr. Kaplan employed many different cultural melodies within the piece to represent the diverse landscape of the province of Saskatchewan, including a Dakota spirit dance, French and Ukrainian folk dances, and a traditional church hymn. In Dr. Kaplan's own words, the piece is dedicated to encouraging understanding and respect among the cultures in Saskatchewan. The images displayed on the screen for you this morning have been selected from the Courtney Milne and the University Photograph Collections and are courtesy of the University Library, University Archives, and Special Collections. The video was produced by Media Production with support from the Library, Special Collections, and Student Enrollment Services and Marketing Communications.